Hi, I'm Nick Haines. Nobody likes being pulled over by the police. If you're in a hurry and you get stopped for speeding, you may say to yourself, are you kidding? There are real criminals out there. Don't these cops have anything better to do? I've said it, at least under my breath, but what if you're a person of color and you don't think you've done anything wrong?
When I was 15 years old, I got stopped by the police and they ran up to my car and put a gun to the window.
The police officer literally just pulled me over and made me prove that I owned the vehicle that I was driving.
These are the stories as shared to us by young people of color on both sides of state line. For the last 20 years, the state of Missouri has been cataloging their experiences. Thanks to a state law passed in the year 2000, every police officer is required to record the race of every driver they stop. The results are eye-opening. The latest numbers compiled by the Attorney General's office finds black drivers in Missouri are 95% more likely to be stopped by police than white drivers. And if you think things are getting better, you may want to know that's actually the biggest gap since the state started collecting that information 2 decades ago. And in some places, the numbers are even more stark. Take Columbia, Missouri.
Over 4 times more likely to pull over a person who is black than a person who is white.
Last year, it was Blue Springs getting flagged.
Black drivers were 175% more likely to get stopped than white drivers.
And remember those riots in Ferguson, Missouri, at the time of the Michael Brown shooting? Black drivers 6 times more likely to be pulled over than whites in that city.
There's not a racial problem in the police department.
So what's happening and why? Could fuzzy data be unfairly tarnishing the police? And amid rising scrutiny over policing in America, are there better ways to root out bias?
Your training is fun because it's like boot camp, but you're training to be a warrior. The only way to stay safe is to assume that everybody wants to hurt you.
This half hour, we're on a search for answers in some unexpected places from police officers themselves. Our program is called Stopped, and it's just getting started. Stay with us.
Funding for Stopped is made possible in part by a grant from the Solutions Journalism Network and from viewers like you. Thank you.
And joining us here in the Kansas City PBS studios from the comfort of their homes and offices is a man who has ran not one, but 2 large law enforcement agencies. Darryl Forte is the former chief of police in Kansas City. He is now the Jackson County Sheriff. Eva Santiago spent 6 years as an officer in the KCPD. She has taught at the police academy and is a former sheriff's deputy in Wyandotte County. Michael Birzer spent 18 years in law enforcement on the Kansas side of our state line. He is now professor of criminal justice at Wichita State University, and the author of the book Racial Profiling, They Stop Me Because I'm Blank. And Gwen Grant is a familiar face to our public television viewers. Gwen and I are the only people on this panel who have never put on a blue uniform. We just both like to talk about police officers a lot. Gwen is the head of the Urban League of Kansas City, which authors the State of Black Kansas City report, which has been tracking police traffic stop data for years. Sheriff Forte, 20 years ago, we've been collecting this data. And 20 years ago, I was just noticing you were being elevated to the commander of the Metro Patrol Division. Were you giving much thought to this new law being passed that we were going to track data on race? Or were you just rolling your eyes that this is going to be more information we have to collect?
No, you know, I was pretty positive about it. I wasn't expecting it to turn out to be basically nothing. I know that sounds mean and cruel, but it really means nothing. As a sheriff and as a police chief, I've never, ever disciplined anyone as a result of the numbers on this report. In 2018, when I was appointed sheriff before the election, I asked about stop reports, and we did a little analysis, and there were 850 stop reports for 2018 that would have never been sent to the Attorney General's office. So everybody's not collecting that data. So again, if we don't have an accountability system, it doesn't mean a whole lot in its current form.
Well, Gwen, about 20 years ago, you were getting ready to become the CEO of the Urban League. When you think back at that time, I mean, did you think this was going to be a really transformational policy change in the state of Missouri? You know, very few states in the entire country were doing that at that point.
Yeah, absolutely. When it was first announced, I thought this is a great thing because certainly it was we were of a mindset in the Black community that certain racial profiling certainly is taking place. But as it turned out, it was a huge disappointment. And you're not being mean, Sheriff Forte. You're just speaking the truth. The report means absolutely nothing at the end of the day because there's no way to track the report to a particular officer, so to pick up any patterns of profiling. So, it, you know, there's no way for a chief to discipline an officer or to coach an officer with regard to the data that's collected.
Eva, you spent 6 years on the streets of Kansas City as a police officer. You were having to collect some of this data. Right now, I see there's about 15 questions on that form. You have to tick on a traffic stop every time you stop anyone in the state of Missouri. Did you think that was like a waste of paperwork when you were an officer?
No, because when I graduated the police academy, that had already been in effect for a couple of years. So it was just part of my training. Maybe the other officers might have thought it was a pain, but that's how I was trained.
Professor Birzer, you have been studying this type of data for years all across the country, and there are concerns about how it is collected. You claim stop data doesn't prove that racial profiling exists in the first place. You say a number of factors may influence who gets ticketed by police. Like what?
Number one is just general deployment practices of police agencies. So I'll give you an example. In areas that have disproportionate amounts of crime, there are going to be more police officers in those areas, and probably they're going to be making greater contact with or more frequent contact with citizens in the form of stops. So that, you know, tendency would raise your data. And unfortunately, many of our racial minority communities are disproportionately affected by crime rates.
Now, I tried to look up, by the way, about what was happening in Kansas on this issue, because we are a bi-state community, of course. Was Kansas doing a better job than Missouri? After exhaustively searching for that data, the answer is no. There isn't one. Most police departments in Kansas don't even break down traffic stops by race, so you have a better chance of finding out whether a driver stopped by the police was in a Toyota Camry or a Ford Focus than whether they were black or white. But the city of Wichita does collect that data, and earlier this year, we find while black drivers make up 11% of the city's residents, they get up to 23% of all the traffic citations. Does that suggest drivers of color fare about the same as they do on the Missouri side?
And I'm familiar with that study because I actually conducted that one. We had to compare that data with a benchmark, which we use U.S. Census data for Wichita. Well, we know that when we look at all the benchmarks we have, U.S. Census data is not very accurate at all. So in other words, 20% of, you know, African-Americans get tickets and they represent 11 point some odd percent of the population. Does that prove racial profiling? No, we can't go that far. There are all types of issues with using census data. It doesn't capture the entire motoring public. It'd be better to capture, you know, who isn't getting tickets.
Gwen.
Is the implication then that blacks or we're committing more crimes, we have all these reasons to be stopped? I have been stopped. I have been racially profiled.
Do you think the data, though? Yes, Sheriff Forte.
Racial profiling in law enforcement is real. I started in 1985. I worked for a sergeant when I worked for Linwood and Truth Station, Central Patrol Division. He told me to my face, four guys in a car is a good traffic stop. And then I had another guy that I pulled up on a car check situation. And I'm not trying to indict every police officer. Most of them are good, decent people. Pulled up on a traffic stop about 11th and Paseo when I was a young officer. And somebody asked him, why did you stop them? He said, because they be black. You know, and then growing up in the organization, going through the ranks like I did, even the sheriff's office, when you reach the top like that, you see some of those things from the way we're treated internally. There was a study done probably 10, 12 years ago at the police department that showed black males were disciplined twice the rate of white males. So when we see that inside, and I had a conversation with someone just recently this week, and he talked about, hey, man, can you believe these people on social media after they retired saying these things about minorities? So those are the same people that were policing our community that came out to, I don't see race, I don't see color, it doesn't matter to me. And then you see on social media. And the first thing I did when I got to the sheriff's office, I canceled the social media policy so I could capture some of that culture. And you'd be surprised what some people say out there when they don't think there's a policy stopping them.
Did you feel that way, Eva, when you were on the Kansas City Police Department for 6 years?
Well, I started my career with KCPD in the area of 27th and Prospects. You're rewarded for making more stops. Five young black males in a car is a good stop, is what I was told, because chances are that somebody in that car is going to have a warrant. What I knew was that I'm just trying to make the world a better place.
Gwen.
To your point about you were trained to to complete the report. And then you're told that, you know, a car full of black men, you know, that's a good stop because you may have a warrant. So we need to really look at how this system is designed to get the very outcome that it's getting. And it disproportionately impacts black and brown people, black people particularly.
Okay. By the way, when you talk about why we're not mentioning other races, the latest traffic report in Missouri says Hispanics, Asians, and Native Americans, according to that data, were stopped at rates below their portion of the driving age population. Professor Birzer, not only did you spend 18 years in law enforcement, but you did a whole year-long project for the Kansas Department of Transportation where you were interviewing and cataloging the responses of law enforcement to this whole question about racial profiling and bias within the police. When they were hit with questions that you are biased, you're pulling me over because I'm black, what was their response when you were talking with them?
There were a number of themes that came out of that. Number one, it went back to it's proactive policing. We don't see race. Another question I asked officers, I said, you know, have you ever been accused of racial profiling on a car stop? And over half of them said, yes, we have. And one officer I remember vividly said, I've been accused probably 24 times of racial profiling. And so I would ask the officers, well, you know, why do you think citizens are saying you're racially profiling them? And the dominant theme that came out of those that data was the fact that intimidation, that they're intimidating us. So they think we're going to get a racial profiling complaint filed against us. It all went back to it's used as an intimidation tactic or to get us to back away from the vehicle because they have something in the vehicle.
Yeah, they didn't want to be searched, Sheriff Forte. They didn't want to get the ticket, and they were using that as an excuse.
You know, maybe in some cases, you know, and I just ask people sometimes and ask them to consider, why don't we pretend the people that saying is racial profiling, that is true, and what are we going to do about it? But sitting at tables, and that's why I don't go to a lot of meetings. You know, we want to talk about why we didn't do it and trying to defend ourselves. It's real. And and if you look around the country and even the Midwest, most law enforcement officials at the top are middle-aged white males. And many of us sitting where we sit, I don't think we really understand the problem. We're making excuses, and we do that. And we grew up like that, including me. I've been in 35 years, and so I think like a police officer in a lot of ways, but we have to change. There's some issues out there that we have to address, and they're not going away.
Okay, we're going to get to those. I want to say, though, while we're tracking the data in Missouri, that doesn't mean Kansas is doing better. We just don't know. They don't collect all those numbers, but a group in Johnson County is now cataloging the stories of young black drivers.
My name is Haile Sims.
My name is Dante Lee.
My name is Brent Austin.
I am a black man living in Johnson County.
I remember my dad getting stopped literally in our neighborhood and the police being like, what are you doing here? Where do you live? And my dad would be like, I live here.
The police officer literally just pulled me over and made me prove that I owned the vehicle that I was driving.
As I was driving down the main street, I seen a cop flip around, do a U-turn, start following me.
Three different cop cars, there's six cops, and it's just me. Nobody else is out here, so anything can happen.
Like, I'm like the squarest person in the world. So what about me did he see that made me look suspicious?
And then his remark was, you should feel lucky that we're looking out for you. I was like, you were not looking out for me because you followed me here.
I could have just caught one little attitude, and you never know what anything. I could be dead, I could be in jail. You never know.
If I'm not perfect, I don't keep my hands exactly where I'm supposed to keep them and do exactly what the police officer says, I could wind up being just a hashtag.
You can hear and see those stories from the Advocacy and Awareness Group of Johnson County on their YouTube and Facebook page. Is just collecting data, though, useful if it doesn't impose any penalties on officers or police departments that don't improve? The law allows the governor to strip state funding from police agencies that don't comply with the state's racial profiling law. That has never happened in 20 years. Our digital news team, Flatland, has been digging into this. They found there have been more than 500 non-filers over the last 20 years. The biggest penalty has been meted out by the Missouri Department of Public Safety, which has withheld some small amounts of training money. What happens, Chief Forte, if you don't submit that data to the state of Missouri?
Absolutely nothing. I can't think of any sanctions against Kansas City because we submitted them, or the sheriff's office. So again, it doesn't mean a whole lot at this point.
Currently, also, you can't look anywhere in the state's annual report on traffic data to find out if one officer in one department, Gwen, is doing most of the stops. In fact, there's no holding accountable individual officers. But what has been the reluctance, though, to add new teeth to this law?
Well, I'm not aware that there's been a strong lobby to actually address the law or to put meat into the law. So after we published our State of Black Kansas City a report in 2019, we included a recommendation that it be amended to allow the governor to withhold funds to law enforcement agencies that show consistently high profiling rates, more so than penalizing them for not turning in the report. They certainly should be sanctioned and penalized for that. But there's nothing in the law, there's no provision in the law to hold them accountable for skyrocketing rates of racial profiling. Those are the kinds of issues that we will be asking our representatives in Jefferson City to address, trying to put some.
But Sheriff Forte says, you know, it means nothing. It's irrelevant, basically. Should we be pointing the finger or spending our time and resources looking in a completely different area? Would it be better, Eva, to invest more time, money and effort in police training, teaching about cultural sensitivity and bias before the officer goes out on the job?
I truly believe that where it has to start is in the police academy. When I was trained in the police academy, you're trained to be a warrior. I did not police in Lee's Summit, and I did not police in white suburban communities. I only policed in urban Kansas City in the urban core. And, you know, the way that we were taught was like, Kansas City's a playground. You go out there and you make as many arrests as you can. And the more arrests you make, the better officer you're going to be. And I think I remember, like, you can't stop them because they're Black. Remember that. But you have to have an excuse to stop them. So in the urban core, it is not hard to find a reason to stop a car. If you are on Independence Avenue and Hardesty all day long, I can find a way to stop a lot of cars.
Professor Birzer, I see you nodding your head too, but you've also been teaching at the Law Enforcement Academy in Wichita.
Right, yes. Let me just dovetail on a point that was made as far as organizations and how organizations, you know, evaluate police officers' performance. That's been problematic in the traditional mindset of organizations, that you're taught to go out and you're expected to write tickets, make arrests, and make cases. And that was it. That was, in large part, a lot of what you got evaluated on. So what that means is you go out and you begin to stop car after car after car. And of course, oftentimes the underlying objective is to find someone with a warrant or find someone with drugs. You don't really see a lot of officers on the front page of the newspapers getting rewarded for going around who made the most community partnerships, but you do find them in the past would get on and you would see a ton seizure of cocaine or a kilogram seizure of cocaine. So I think that kind of that traditional organizational mindset really needs to change the way we evaluate officers and training as well.
Are we rewarding the wrong things in the police departments, Sheriff Forte?
When I was a new sergeant in 1992, I told my people, I want to give you credit for positive citizen contacts. That's stopping people on the corner, pedestrian checks, what they used to be, and just talking to them. Don't run them through the computer, just building relationships. I had a commander come to me and said, nope, if you stop and talk to them, run them through the computer. People just don't get it. And we're suffering from that now because other industries and occupations have to change with time because they're profit-driven. We're not, so we just keep doing what we've been doing and nothing happens.
Gwen, I was actually looking at what happens in training in the Kansas City Police Department, their police academy. And take a look at this. For new recruits, it includes a 9-hour class in cultural diversity, a 4-hour mediation class, up to 3 hours on minority relations, a 28-hour class on vehicle and pedestrian checks, and a 4-hour class in ethics and professionalism. Now, that seems kind of comprehensive to me.
The hours of training, you know, certainly it's important that they have diversity training, bias training, and those things. But if if it just stops there in the classroom with they went through and they checked off the box that they had it, and it's not translated not only into how they actually show up in the community, but the culture inside the department. And you know, I've had some engagement with social psychologists and asked the question, why is it, you know, we do these diversity trainings, we put people through implicit bias training, but we see no changes inside organizations and how they function. We see no changes in systems, because implicit bias training does not work if you do not understand or even own the fact that you do have a bias.
Can you train someone not to be biased, Gwen?
You can help people to be aware of their biases, and then they can learn how to check their behavior. You know, those are learned behaviors that they've had, and so they've got to unlearn them. And so it starts with being aware.
Ava.
So when I taught at the police academy, I taught implicit bias. They gave me 1 hour. I had 1 hour to teach implicit bias. And I was like, well, at least I got that. And my first question would be like, who here has implicit bias? And I think maybe one or two people would be like, like, because they knew they did, but nobody else was raising their hand. And then by the time I did my introduction and who I was and just this and that and housekeeping, and now I have 45 minutes.
Well, okay, so what change would you propose then for how we train the police officers of our future?
Take that curriculum and just tear it up. Throw it out and start from scratch.
And what would be in that start from scratch?
You'd have to go even before that into the hiring processes. So just the hiring practices, because I was in the employment department, it so disproportionately eliminates people of color. If you have 100 applicants and 80 are white and 20 are people of color, once they go through the first step, there's like 5 people of color.
Sheriff Forte.
You go look at the academy. They want to take everybody's picture of the day you graduate from the academy. Go back and take that same class picture 3 years from there and see how many of the people of color or women are still there.
Okay, Professor Birzer, I wanted to get back with you here. We've heard a lot of things ripping up the police academy curriculum. Hey, you're getting paid to teach at the law enforcement academy. You don't want to lose any of that income, do you?
I can't tell you, as someone that's actually studied police training for a number of years and published on this issue, I would agree our police training curriculum needs to be totally revamped. If you look, we put about 80% of our training time into training police recruits on what they're going to be doing about 20 or 25% of the time. That's the real crime fighting stuff. But, you know, how much are we putting into problem solving skills, community policing skills, interpersonal skills? And those things, you know, are important. We require officers to go back twice a year, 3 times, 4 times a year to qualify with their firearms, which is important. But how often do we require them to go back and go through a conflict resolution class and to qualify with their communication skills? Most departments, it's not done.
Well, the good news in the state of Missouri, isn't that what they're going to be doing? The governor of Missouri, Sheriff Forte, just announced that starting in January, all officers will have to take a 2-hour training class on de-escalation techniques and recognizing implicit bias. And if they don't, they can't keep their badges, by the way. What difference will that make?
I think it's a good start, but as leaders of the organization, we shouldn't shoot for minimum standards. I started the de-escalation training in Kansas City, Missouri, at the Kansas City, Missouri Police Department, and I got a lot of pushback just from that. They said, we're going to be cowards. And if you look at a lot of our policies around the country, we had in our policy that I had removed, you can't display cowardliness. That was in our policy. It was in policy at the sheriff's office. So they teach you certain things not to back up, or you might not have a job. And I've heard this over and over recently. Only if they would have listened to the directions, this wouldn't have happened. And these are senior law enforcement officials. If they would only listen, we'd never gone to step two. So I applaud the governor for doing that. But there's going to be, again, we can't do the minimum standard on any of this.
Okay, I don't think Gwen Grant is applauding the governor on that. Why, Gwen?
No, I'm fine with the governor putting that out there, you know, but what impact is it really going to have? What you have to pay attention to are policies. So the policies, we don't have de-escalation policies in KCPD. So going through 2 hours of de-escalation training, when that's not a policy or a practice that is sanctioned by the police chief and the FOP, then you're not going to see a lot of change just because someone got some training in it.
Gwen talked about the need to change departmental policies. And there is some concern, we can, you know, beyond anything to do with stop traffic data, if there is this distrust between the public and the police and why it is that so many African Americans particularly are stopped, it's because of departmental policies, Professor Birzer, it is argued, that the police are actually policing far greater the African American communities.
That's correct. So, you know, deployment patterns, you know, they vary between agencies, and typically they're going to be more deployed or greater deployment in areas that have higher crime rates. And, you know, going back again, you know, if we're looking at data, you know, data is important. It can really inform us in a lot of different areas on, you know, police stopping practices. But if we really want to start getting to the meat of racial profiling, there are other ways we can do that. And I'm a firm believer that much of this needs to really evolve to self-evaluations within the training environment. Officers critically reflecting on their stop practices. You know, I'm stopping, here's who I've stopped the last month. How would this look to the citizens if they had if they could view my stop practices? I think that's very, very important as well.
Most people will view it that the police are doing a good job. They're trying to do the right thing. There may be some bad apples. Sheriff Forte, you actually proposed a statewide misconduct database that would hit at those sort of bad apples, those to track those problem officers. That was back in June, and I can't say I've ever heard anything else about it since then. What happened? Was the idea dropped? You got no interest in that?
No, the legislature, you know, they don't convene until January for the regular session. I'm trying to do some things internally. I can't talk about them yet because the staff doesn't really know. But what has happened, and I have a few from the sheriff's office since I've been there, you leave before there's an investigation. There's nothing in the file. They resign, and then they get to go to a neighboring agency. We have people there at the sheriff's office that should have never been hired in law enforcement. You know, and they left other agencies to come here. We have a couple at the sheriff's office that can't testify in court because of their background. So, and they're sworn deputies. So most of the people in law enforcement are great people, but most is not good enough when you talk about the power and authority that we have when you can take a life in a moment. So again, my brothers and sisters out there, I want to say thank you for serving in law enforcement. Most do a good job, but again, most is not good enough. We need all to do a good job.
And on that, I need to stop, or should I say stopped, as that's the name of the program, Sheriff Darryl Forte, Professor Michael Birzer, former police officer, Eva Santiago, and Urban League CEO Gwen Grant. Thank you. We've prodded and poked our guests over a lot of different facets of this issue over the last half hour. If we have in any way piqued your interest or left you with questions, we have so much reporting to share with you, along with a number of video portraits that track how this is playing out in Kansas City, all thanks to our multimedia reporting team in our digital newsroom, Flatland. Check it out for yourself at flatlandkc.org/stopped. I'm Nick Haines. From all of us here at Kansas City PBS, ease off the accelerator, watch those rolling stops, and don't think about speeding through that red light. Good night.